Hello, and welcome to ESL RPG. Today we are looking at playingcards.io in more detail. We will also look at the game we are playing recently on the podcast, Remote Insensitivity. This is the playingcards.io version of Cards Against Humanity. Yes, Cards Against Humanity. So now, warning. Both the original game and Remote Insensitivity feature cards very not safe for work. It is a little hard to avoid with this game. This video, and the podcast to match, will not be censored. Censoring them would make some parts impossible to understand. Instead, a similar warning will run before the podcast, and in this video, we will show how you can make this game okay for class. Okay, let's start from the website. And hey, look, some new games from last time, like Joking Hazard and Escoba. Anyway, to start the game, click on the game you want to start to play. In this case, Remote Insensitivity. This will take you to a new page. Click Start Game, and it will make a room for your game. To play with friends, copy this link at the top or this link here and send it to your friends. For both the host and your friends, to enter the room, click Enter here. And here we are in the room. Let's go over a few points here. On the left, you see buttons for the menu, edit mode, share, and full screen. At the top, you see the prompt cards on the left and the answer deck to the right. To the right of the prompt cards is the space for that round's prompt. And to the right of the answer deck is the discard pile. Under those are spaces for players' answers. And at the bottom is the hand. Only you can see cards in your hand. As before, to take or move a card, click and drag. And to flip a card, just click. Now, this system is not 3D, so all the players have the same layout. There is no table to sit around, everyone's hand is at the bottom, and all other pieces are in the same places. This is convenient because everyone sees the same thing and can understand easily. But there are some limitations. First, there is no button to draw or deal cards. You can recall all the cards and use the same button to shuffle them, but everyone must draw cards themselves. Also, if one player is dragging a card, other players cannot click or drag that card. Okay, let's talk playing this game. First thing you might want to do is go into edit mode. You'll see these places on the left and right for players. First thing you should do is rename them for each of your players. Of course, if you have less than six players, you can delete what you don't need. While we are here, add either a game piece or a checkers piece. Let's also add a spinner. We will use those later. Now that that is ready, everyone draw 10 cards and we can start. To play this game, one person is the judge. You can use dice or rock, paper, scissors or some other method to decide who goes first. Earlier, we put in a spinner. So you can have everyone spin it and the highest number is the first judge. Okay. Give the judge the piece we put in earlier. That piece will be the judge marker. To keep things easy, put the marker on the judge's space. The judge will draw a prompt. Now, the judge won't do anything yet. The other players will each choose an answer from their hand. The judge does not. They then put those answers all in one pile. If you want, you can flip the card before taking it from your hand, but as you can see here, any card you take from your hand automatically flips over. Also, you always have 10 cards. After using a card, take a card. When the pile is ready, the judge can click the number on the left corner. Shuffle the stack, and then spread them out. Now it can be very funny, so I usually have the judge read the prompt with the answers as they flip each one. For example, what is Batman's guilty pleasure?
A whole thing of butter.
What is Batman's guilty pleasure?
Assless chaps.
What is Batman's guilty pleasure?
Serfdom.
Sometimes they're more funny, but usually when other people are choosing. Now here is why the judge is named so. He will choose whatever card he thinks is the best answer. Most people go with the funniest, but how the judge chooses is up to them. The person who played that card wins, and they get the prompt put in their space. This is how you keep score. And then all the answer cards go in the discard pile. Now there are a few ways you can choose who is the next judge. You can have the winner go next. This is often good for game balance, so the winner last round can't win the next round. You could rotate around the table. This gives everyone a chance to play as the judge. Or you can spin the spinner to keep it random. All are good, but I usually have the winner judge the next round. Either way, pass the judge marker to the next judge. Okay, last bit. You keep track of points to decide the winner. You can play this game by a number of rounds. For example, after 10 rounds, the player with the most prompt cards is the winner. In that case, add a counter to keep track of the round numbers. Or you can play first to a certain number of points. In this case, say 3. After a player collects 3 prompts, they are the winner. And the game is over. Or you can play on a time limit, something maybe a little more common if you are playing with a class. Or if you just want to have fun, keep the game going as long as it's fun. This is up to you. But you should tell your players which one at the beginning. Oh, and one more thing. During play, you might see a prompt card with 2 answer slots. This means players must give 2 answers. That's a little problem because any way you shuffle either mixes the order of the answers or different players' answers together. Here's an easy fix. Each player puts the first card in each space and their second card underneath. All right, that is how you play and how you do basic setup. But if you're watching this and are a teacher, or don't like all the dirty, dirty words bad people use, or just want to make this game easier for ESL players, let me show you how you can do that. And if you want to make a completely different game, you can do that too. There are two ways to change the cards, but both will require quite a bit of work, especially since there are 100 prompts and almost 500 answers. Let me show you the direct way first, then the tricky, but more useful way. Okay, to edit directly, first enter edit mode, then click on a deck. That will bring up a menu. Now, change deck template won't change anything except how all the cards in one deck look, but in case you want to go that deep, let's take a look. All right, when you open it up, you will see some layers here and here. You will also notice a setting for the front and back. If you click on the layers, you will notice this layer is set to all the same. That is because for all of the cards, this will be the exact same thing. But if we click here, a few things change. First, it says different per card. That is because these change for each card. But also look here where it says field name. This will be important later, especially if you want to make your own decks. While we are here, you can see you can also change the size or layout of the cards. For example, to make them sideways, if you want to make flashcards. You can also add extra layers, either text or image, if you like. All right, let's look at the next option, add or remove cards. This is the more important one for editing the deck. As you can see, all the text different on each of the cards is listed here. You can very easily edit each card one by one. Like I said, very direct and in that way easy, but there's one issue. You can't save your custom decks here or transfer them between games by exporting those decks. For both of those, notice this button at the bottom marked Import CSV. With this button, you can use a CSV you prepared before to set up a game for your friends or students, or share a custom deck with other people, or what have you. So let's go over how to make those CSVs. Okay, you could use Microsoft Excel to do this, or you can use Google Sheets. Let's use Google Sheets. First, one page makes one CSV file. So one page is one deck. We need two decks, so let's make two pages. Now, you remember the field name from before. That has to go in the first column. And there. Under that, one line for each of the cards. Write the card text into the row, move to the next row, repeat, repeat, repeat. I'll be honest, that is a lot of work. But the good news is that at the end, you have a CSV you can use in any playingcards.io room. And if you're using this to make a flashcard game or some other type of game, all the better, because you will be starting from scratch anyway. Of course, there are a few shortcuts you can do to make things go a little faster. For example, you can't export from playingcards.io, but you can copy each card one by one and paste each one into each line, then change as you see fit. Another option is just downloading and printing the list of cards from the Cards Against Humanity website and using it as a base for writing each one of your own. Lastly, if you look around on Google, you can find some spreadsheets for Cards Against Humanity cards you can use as a base to build off of. You can see I have two examples here. Either way, let's change things a little. We will now make a sample set of flashcards. First, let's open a custom deck and set the layout. Let's change the height and width so we have wide cards. Let's also delete the image layers because we don't really need them. To keep it simple, let's add a text layer on the front named front. And one on the back named back. Don't forget to set both to different for each card. Here. Now, back to Google Sheets. You can see me starting a new page here. Layer name at the top, but now making two layer names. Remember, one row, one card. So in this column, we write some sample words. And in this one, sentences they fit in. By the way, if you were putting in images in an image layer different for each card, you would have to put in the URL for that image. So either find it online and copy the link, or upload it online and copy the link. Okay, from now it will be the same whether you are replacing cards in the Remote Insensitivity deck or making a custom flashcard or other card deck. Take this page, go to File, Download, Comma Separated Values, CSV Current Sheet. Save it. You will now find a CSV file in your download folder. I recommend moving it somewhere you can quickly find it. Okay, back to playingcards.io. Let's choose our custom deck and choose Add or Remove Cards. Yes, there are a lot of cards here, but don't worry. Let's just go down to the bottom. Here, you'll see a button, Import CSV. Click it and go to the CSV you created earlier. Upload it and voila. Now, you will notice that all of these cards you made earlier have zero cards right now. So go to the bottom, all plus one, and click it. Now, if we get out of edit mode, you will see we have our flashcards with the words on the front and the sentences on the back. Easy, done. By the way, a small notice, but this method will be similar for any website or program for creating flashcards, such as Memrise, that also has support for CSV uploads. Be careful though, as those websites might have different rules for formatting. All right, that should have you mostly covered. Feel free to play around with this and try other games and ideas. If you'd like, check out the podcast where you can hear us play this or other games. Also, if you want to support more videos and playtests of games like these, please consider supporting us on Patreon, like our patron, King Michael, Tailless Master of Eagles, Teacher of Rocks, and Ruler of the Land of Awesome. Thank you and enjoy.